The views and opinions expressed on this program are not necessarily those of this station, JVC Broadcasting Management, or its sponsors.
Hi, I'm Karen Signoracci. For over 20 years, I've devoted my career to helping nonprofits reach their goals, increase their funding, broaden their donor base, and their community outreach. In addition, I work with my nonprofit clients to get the right people around the table to serve and execute the mission of the organization for its betterment and its service to the community. If you're considering starting a nonprofit, serve on a nonprofit board of directors, or are currently struggling to get your organization to the next level, please visit KarenSCS.com. That's KarenSCS.com. Let me know how I can help you increase your efficiency. One of the key components to a successful nonprofit are its board of directors. They are integral to the success by setting strategy, vision, and taking on fiduciary responsibility. Making key decisions is also part of this role. Please visit KarenSCS.com. That's KarenSCS.com. And let's speak about making your nonprofit and your vision. Hello and welcome. This is The Big Picture on 103.9 Long Island News Radio. I am your host, Karen Signoracci. I've spent the last 20 years working with nonprofits, raising money, building nonprofit boards, community awareness. And my PSA before I start every show is I hope you'll hear something today that you can bring back to your family, to your place of business, to your block, to your neighborhood, to your community and say, I want to do something. I want to get involved. And there's so many positive stories on Long Island of the great work that nonprofits are doing, that people are doing, and we are going to talk about one of those today. And I am very happy that today I have Bill Whiting. Hello, Bill.
Hello, good morning. Happy early Halloween.
Early Halloween, that's right. We are going to talk about a lot of different things. We're going to talk about how we know each other, but we, you know, we always start the big picture. We have to talk about a little food or wine, and you are like the perfect guest for this question. And I've gotten so many great answers from all my past guests. But can you tell us something that you've eaten recently? Perhaps you made it home or somewhere you've eaten recently that you care to share.
Last night, because the temperature got a little cooler, it was raining, I made a pappardelle with duck ragu.
Fabulous.
It was awesome. It wasn't Long Island duck, though, unfortunately.
All right. But
it was duck.
But it was duck. And so just give us a little background here, though. You have a wine background, you have a food background, and we're going to get into your professional background, but we are going to talk about how we know each other.
Exactly.
So you and I both attended the University of Dayton.
Correct.
In Dayton, Ohio.
Love them. Go Flyers.
Go Flyers. And you know, so many people would turn to me and say, how from Long Island, you know, I grew up in Mineola, how'd you get to Dayton? And the truth is I had a family friend that went there and I went to take a tour and that was it. But how did you get to Dayton?
Actually, almost the same thing. I had a cousin that went there and I also played water polo. So at the time, Dayton had a water polo team that was ranked in the top 25.
They were.
And there was it was a great, great place. If I were to do it all over again, I would do it again. It was great. I love the University of Dayton and I love the community. I love the people. It was so much fun.
I agree. I agree 100%. And I think the one thing I've always even struggled to explain to people as you travel through your professional career, what was so great about Dayton was that there was a very strong sense of community.
Absolutely. I got a group text message this morning. There's 20 of us that are on a group text from Dayton. No joke.
That is awesome.
And we actually meet once a year because Dayton, of course, is known for its basketball. So instead of having a football reunion, we do a basketball reunion, and usually the last game of the year, the last home game of the year.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And it is true. You do meet people that you will stay in touch with for life.
I was just online the other day at CVS, and I had my Flyer sweatshirt on, and somebody turned around and said, "You go to Dayton?" It was great. And it was actually someone who I knew.
Oh, that's
crazy.
Went
to Dayton as well, so...
Small world, but you know, but here we are. So we're going to say it one more time. Go Flyers.
Go Flyers.
Go Flyers. And thank you for that experience. Both of us would say a note of gratitude for that experience that shaped and molded us to where we are today.
It's such a great community. It really is.
It really is.
I still have friends there. I actually was with three of my friends. We drove up to Detroit for a little weekend. So
awesome.
Love them.
All good stuff. So let's talk about Bill's Blend Wine, and let's talk about your professional background, and we're going to get into a lot of good things here, but give us the background on your wine.
So Bill's Blend actually started as a fluke. It was 2013. A group of colleagues, we went out to Oregon and Washington, and we attended the Washington Grape Growers Association annual benefit gala. And there they had a live auction and a silent auction.
Oh, this is great.
So, of course, after a few glasses of wine, you get a little courage, and you put your name down on the silent auction. I wasn't thinking I was going to win, but it was actually a brand new half French, half American oak barrel. There was no wine in it. And I put my name on it, and next thing you know, they call my name up, and I said, oh, can you just have that shipped to me? And they're like, you really didn't read the rules. You're supposed to take it with you tonight. So I told my friend, I said, hopefully you have a station wagon with you. So I said, well, we have this barrel. What are we going to do? And my friend said, well, they're auctioning off at the live auction a ton of Cabernet Sauvignon. So, of course, I put my paddle up, and once you know it, I started sinking in my seat because they called my number and I won.
Wow.
So we had a ton of Cabernet and a half American, half French oak barrel, and we started making wine. That was a 2013 vintage. So basically, it was a one-off. And then we had the wine. It was basically for friends and family, and everyone loved it, raved about it, and didn't think anything of it. And then after COVID hit, I got the idea, said, you know what? We made this work. Let's do it again. And Bill's Blend was really born then.
So basically, the first birthday of Bill's Blend was 2013.
2013.
After this gala,
yes,
and this fundraising. And you were like the perfect guest at a gala of a fundraising event because you were having a few drinks, shopping, you know, buying. We like that. And then you came, you know, all these years, a few years later, and obviously, you know, COVID impacted that. And then it became your full-time project.
It did.
And so from what the term fluke, it's become a massive undertaking.
It is. And it's so much fun, though.
And you're on this entrepreneurial journey.
I am.
So what before that was your professional background? Listen, let's just really go back to basics for 1 second. What did you study at UD?
Sales. It was sales, marketing, communication. It really wasn't a specialized. It was a school of business.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it was, again, sales, marketing, public relations. And so I started after college. One of the things I've always wanted to do was, since I played water polo, I wanted to play in the Olympics, unfortunately. That didn't happen, but I got a job with the Atlanta Committee for the Olympic Games.
Oh, wow.
So I did work for the Olympic Committee in 1996 in Atlanta. And then after that, I decided to pursue a career in the wine industry because my grandfather actually founded an importing company here in New York in 1919. So I figured, why not try and follow in the footsteps of him and the rest of the family? So I did that and been doing that ever since. And that was in 1997.
Wow, and here you are.
And here I am.
So for the purpose of right now, for Bill's Blend, can you give us the website?
Yes, it's billsblendwine.com.
Okay, and for what with people that are listening, can you tie in like what you'd want them to know, maybe if they're interested in wine, or what you'd want them to know about what you're doing, or you know, what have you learned?
The one thing that I've learned over the years is just remember, wine is food. Wine is a living thing. Wine and food, not only do they hold hands, but they become intimate with one another. They need one another. And with wine, you just have to remember, drink what you like. That is the most important thing. Try to please your palate. Don't be intimidated by what anyone else has to say. If you like a white wine, that's great. If you like a red wine, that's great. If you like a rosé, that's wonderful. Drink what you like. And that's where the beauty is when there's tastings all throughout the country, all at your local retailers or restaurants will have wine dinners. You get an opportunity to try different things that are outside your comfort zone, whether it be a different region, a different country. And I always love it because you get an opportunity to taste something that you've never had before and you might like it.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's what's great about wine. There's thousands and thousands of different grape varieties from all over the world.
So do you find yourself still learning?
Oh, every single day. Absolutely. Yes.
And that's the great thing about life, too, is that we're always learning. We're students. Remember, you say we're students in life, students in the game of life.
That's right.
And you're learning and you're encouraging people, too, to maybe get out of their comfort zone.
Sure.
I always like to say sometimes you have to be uncomfortable. Great growth comes with being uncomfortable.
Absolutely. 1,000%.
And that could apply to wine. That can apply to being an entrepreneur.
To everything. It can apply to everything. Everything in life.
So the event that you referenced, though, just to tie it back before our break, have you gone back to that event?
No. I have not. I'm afraid what might happen.
Part two. This is The Big Picture on 103.9 Long Island News Radio. Bill Whiting is here. When we come back, we're going to talk about some of the other things he's done with Bill's Blend, some philanthropic endeavors. And listen, you're going to learn. You're hopefully going to, again, be inspired and think about what you can do in our local community right here. This is The Big Picture, 103.9 Long Island News Radio. Welcome back. This is The Big Picture on 103.9 Long Island News Radio. I am your host, Kara Signoracci, and today I'm talking to Bill Whiting of Bill's Blend Wine. We covered our connection to the University of Dayton. We covered Bill's entrepreneurial journey to get here and the first birth of Bill's Blend in 2013, and then COVID and Bill taking it full force. And one of the things I always like to see when I'm scrolling through LinkedIn or Instagram or Facebook or even talking to people is people are deciding to do something in a charitable sense that's unique and that's different. You know, last week I talked to a colleague that did a paddle boarding event to raise money. And, you know, I was really interested to see how you chose the Maui wildfire relief and supporting those initiatives and the tragedy that happened there with the wine. So tell me how this came to be.
So we were getting ready to bottle our second vintage of the red wine and also our first vintage of the rosé. And I flew out to Washington on August the 13th. And at that point in time, the wildfires were raging, and because those wildfires were basically around August 4th to the 11th. And if you've ever been to Maui, you know it's big with hospitality, and the people there are just absolutely wonderful. And to see them lose everything, it just broke your heart. And we were bottling, and all we kept hearing was the news of the tragedy that was going on in Maui. And I just came up with this idea. I said, you know, I'm only producing 168 cases of this. And I said, and I know some people that were affected. I said, why not do something for them? So I decided to get all my net proceeds from the rosé wine and donate them to five different Maui charities. And the thing is, the official flower of Maui is the pink damask rose. And of course, pink symbolizes warmth, friendliness, joy, gratitude, and openness, just like the people of Maui. So it's fitting that the wine that was chosen was our pink-colored rosé. And the five charities that I chose were personal. They were the Restaurant and Hospitality Fund for Maui, which helped with displaced individuals and staff. There was the Maui Humane Society, and they were actually the first ones to be allowed to go into Ground Zero and rescue animals. There was a local fund for communities impacted by the wildfires that were for local Hawaiian natives. There was a Salvation Army and also the Public Schools of Hawaii Foundation, because some of the schools were burned so badly that students had to be transported to other schools. So those were the five charities that I chose.
So through your career and through your work all these years, you obviously knew people that were impacted.
Yes.
And there's an interesting connection here, because you've mentioned a few associations which are not traditional nonprofits, but still have that sense of giving back and community and, you know, a common theme coming together. And then also, your just relationships. And that's how this came to be.
Yeah, absolutely. And I did my homework on the charities, too. And I think if you are going to give to a charity, you should do your homework. and learn more about it, more about these organizations. Then I know that all five of these, 100% of the proceeds was going to the people that were affected.
That's a very important point. And a lot of people, you know, they call me or they text me and they say, Karen, you know, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? But research beyond the website is valuable.
Absolutely.
Valuable.
I think it's important because, I mean, if, first of all, just to be able to give back. Mm-hmm. One of my theories in life is give back more than what you take. And I hate to have my money go somewhere where 60% of it is being given to an individual for their salary. I want it 100% to be to the actual individuals who are suffering and need the help.
So you did your research on those five.
And I think everyone should if they're going to give to a charity. Absolutely.
Sure, you should. And it, the resources are out there and they're available.
Thank God for the internet.
The internet, exactly. And the honest truth is you picked a cross section of five organizations. So you really kind of hit a lot of different areas. And your research kind of gave you that guidelines.
Exactly.
To do that.
It was nice to spread things out.
What when life takes these twists and turns and you've done all these different things and a pandemic was thrown in there and even, you know, tragedy with wildfires, natural disaster, what has been your aha moment that it all clicked for you when you said, you know what, this is all
There was two aha moments. There was the aha moment where there was belief that I could do something. Mm-hmm. And that came actually before COVID. I was actually lecturing at a school up in Ithaca that holds the Guinness Book of World Records for the largest wine class in the world. And I was in an auditorium with 700 people.
That's the largest.
And I spoke for 4 hours without taking a breath.
Wow.
And that to me was my aha moment where I said, you know what? All these years, you know, it's just your practice. It's getting out there, being on the road, you know, rolling up your sleeves. When I did that, that was the wow. If I can do this, I can do anything. And then, of course, when we had the first vintage of Bill's Blend come out in 2019, and everything was sold out just by word of mouth, and everyone, the support was just overwhelming, and everybody's reaction to it. It was just a very proud moment because you're always your own worst critic. And so I beat myself up a lot over things. But when everything came back, all the positive responses and the love, it was very, very, very wow. I guess you could say it was a wow moment.
It was a wow moment for you.
Yeah.
And all of those years and practice and the relationships. I mean, mm-hmm. You're in the relationship business. Like so many nonprofits and entrepreneurs and people that are networking, you're in the relationship business of building relationships.
We're people business.
We're in the people business. That's funny, Bill, because I always, you know, there's always truth in a joke, and I always say it, but I always joke, I'm not good at anything but talking to people and dealing with people. And then everything else can unfold from there. And that's what we're in, whether you're donating to charities that matter to you, whether you're doing your research, whether you're at a networking event, it comes back to people.
It's a feel-good experience, too. Mm-hmm.
It is. Can you tell us the website one more time for
Bill? Yes, it's www.billsblendwine, all one word, .com.
So I just want to bring up one other thing. You know, one of the things I like to do here on Long Island is support small businesses. And when I do ask people in the beginning of the show, you know, where they've eaten recently or what they've made, I'm always so happy when someone says a small business because they're the lifeblood of our community.
Absolutely.
They are the heartbeat of our community.
We need them.
We do need them. So I'm going to ask you a little on the spot here, but any small businesses that you care to share that you have found a remarkable experience at or that you have a relationship with?
Well, being in hospitality, of course, and being in the wine industry, it's local retailers, mm-hmm. local restaurants.
Right.
That's who I love supporting. There's a lot of great chain restaurants that are out there. Don't get me wrong, they're wonderful too, but we always like supporting local.
I agree 100%. Local businesses, whether it is for food or wine or anything, really, even, you know, some of the basics.
Even our little hardware store.
I was just thinking about that. You know, Ace Costello, they do a lot of great work. They've supported, you know, one of my clients, and it's a great option.
Even grocery chains, you know, local we used to call them in Ohio IGAs.
IGAs, that's right. We did call them that. That's right. So this has been great. We covered a lot. Is there anything else that you want people to know that are listening?
You know, as I mentioned before, my philosophy is give back more than what you take. And also, you'll accomplish much if you don't mind who gets the credit.
That's true.
If you take those two things, you'll go very far in life. And one of the things I always like to do is when I end an event or end a dinner, I always like to give a toast. So this is a great toast, especially with Thanksgiving coming up. Here's to lying, cheating, and stealing. If you're going to lie, lie to save a friend. If you're going to cheat, cheat death. And if you're going to steal, steal the heart of the person you love.
That's it. That's it right there. I like it, Bill. I like it a lot. That's terrific. I'm glad that we could do this. I'm glad that we could talk. I'm so thrilled that we got to know each other a little bit better.
Absolutely.
Today, and I look forward to seeing each other again and learning more about what you do. And thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Happy Halloween. Happy Thanksgiving. Happy holidays.
All good. This is The Big Picture on 103.9 Long Island News Radio. Thanks for being here.
The views and opinions expressed on this program are not necessarily those of this station, JVC Broadcasting Management, or its